So welcome everybody. My name is Davide Tommaso Ferrando. I am an architecture critic and curator and founding member of the Unfolding Pavilion and currently a research fellow at the Faculty of Design and Arts of the Free University of Bolzano. Today, I'm going to introduce and moderate this roundtable dedicated to architecture exhibitions. And this roundtable is titled Exhibitionists. The title makes explicit reference to an essay by writer and curator Tina Di Carlo, which posits exhibitionism as a form of spatial praxis, which could be assumed by architecture curating. According to Di Carlo, the concept of exhibitionism identifies, and I'm quoting now, an act of display that denudes, disrupts, and challenges norms, proposing an open project, a methodological approach, and a reflexive position. In such a frame, architecture curators, and I'm quoting again, speak through exhibitions rather than about exhibitions. And these exhibitions are not intended as passive objects in the sense of the final products of ideas and representations, but rather as active things. Things which are capable of gathering elements and producing events. So exhibitionism, in this sense, connotes a kind of display that acts, as Di Carlo writes. Finally, exhibitionism proposes that exhibitions should not represent architecture within the space of a gallery, but should rather produce architecture within architectural space. As a consequence, exhibitionism as a notion makes the distinction between exhibition and architecture collapse. Now, Tina Di Carlo's essay was published in 2010, 10 years ago. And since then, we have clearly witnessed the multiplication of architecture exhibitions that could easily fit in her notion of exhibitionism. And I think this is particularly true for exhibitions which have been curated in the context of recent architecture biennales and triennales. Today, it's the 22nd of May, 2020. Today would have been the opening, as you probably already know, of the 17th International Architecture Exhibition at the Biennale di Venezia. And this is the reason for today we have gathered here on Zoom the curators of three pavilions which took place in Venezia during the last three editions of the Architecture Biennale. Three kinds of exhibitionism, we could say, which pose fundamental questions about what it means and what it entails to exhibit architecture today. So these are the Airbnb Pavilion, which took place in 2014, the Portuguese Pavilion titled Neighbourhood, where Alvaro meets Aldo, which took place in 2016, and the Unfolding Pavilion, which took place in two editions, once in 2016 and once in 2018. Now, in this first part of our talk, I'm going to give space to the curators of these three pavilions who will briefly present their respective projects. And after that, we will open up a conversation, a debate between our guests and, of course, the public. As far as the public is concerned, I'm already like a small technicality. If you feel like intervening, please just ask so by means of writing a message on the chat. We will find you and we will put you online in streaming so you can ask the question yourself. Both your microphone and webcam could be activated. If you want to ask a question but you don't want to be streamed online, you can just write the question and write that you don't want to ask the question yourself, so I will ask the question for you in that case. So, if it's all clear and without further ado, and expressing, of course, our gratitude to Ellis, Rosie, and the Architecture Foundation for this very nice opportunity they have given us to be here today, I would like to invite to take the microphone our first guests for the night. And these are Fabrizio Ballabio, Alessandro Bava, and Octave Perrot, which I think they're all online right now. Just to introduce them briefly, Fabrizio Ballabio is a doctoral researcher in architectural history at the University of York and a teaching member of Studio Kersengers at the Academia di Architettura di Mendrisio. And also between 2014 and 18, he was a founding member of the art collective AIR, just like Alessandro Bava and Octave Perrot. Alessandro Bava is an architect and writer based in Naples, in Italy. And Octave Perrault is an architect and curator based in Paris, who was also a founding member, apart from the collective IRE, he was also curator of the Cruising Pavilion at the 16th Venice Architecture Biennale in 2018. Please.
Hi, everyone. So I will start, it's going to be very short, I'll speak 1 minute, then Fabrizio and Alessandro will also speak 1 minute. So the Airbnb Pavilion was an exhibition that took place over 3 days during the opening days of the 14th Architecture Biennale in 2014. That was the Biennale that Rem Koolhaas curated. And it started basically with a name, mainly the Airbnb Pavilion, and the fierce intention to address the digital today on how it was affecting cities, urbanism, architecture in many ways. And it was at the moment where our architecture was, the Airbnb was just starting to show how pervasive basically such platforms could be down to our domestic spaces. And we're also reacting to the context of the Biennale of Rem, which was kind of framing itself as a closing chapter of modernity, but there was very little that was addressing actually what was coming next. It was very looking back. So we wanted to really make a stance in that regard. So the exhibition was curated by four of us. So there was Alessandro Bava, Fabrizio Ballabio, and myself who are here, but also Luis Ortega Govela, who couldn't be present. And we're all basically straight fresh out of school. And so it was a very DIY show. And what we did was to invite 25 architects and 25 artists to contribute, to basically address the new condition of domesticity that was created or emerging with the houses becoming this kind of online commodities. And so the request was very simple to the artists. We asked them to, we commissioned them to design an interior or to make a representation of an interior. And the architects, we showed one project from each, only a plan, without any context, just an interior. And we flew, and the one criteria was to that they could fit inside a suitcase, so we could fly with EasyJet with the exhibition to install it inside an Airbnb. And that's Alison was going to tell you more about the location.
Alessandro, maybe you're muted.
Okay, sorry, it took me a second to unmute myself. So basically, as Octavo was saying, I mean, doing this exhibition in Venice, the exhibition of the 25 architects and 25 artists was almost an excuse in a way to address and to open up these interiors that were suddenly available thanks to this platform. So actually the main thing that was on show in this exhibition was actually this Airbnb, this flat, which was available on Airbnb, which was in a neighborhood in Venice near the Palazzo Grassi. And so in a way, I think the most important thing, the most important operation I think that we did with this project was to open up this kind of unpedigreed architecture for people to visit, as if it was in the same context of the, let's say, the canon defining architects who exhibit inside the official pavilions and the official exhibition. So there is an interesting thing because basically we advertised the exhibition as if it was happening in more than one location. But in fact, what happened is that we just simply photographed the exhibition in other flats, for example, in London. Because the idea for that was that this exhibition was very sort of impromptu, and it was only open for a couple of days in Venice. So it existed mainly online. And in fact, one of the moments that actually people managed to participate in this exhibition was or to see this exhibition was actually online, and we did a live stream. So it's really funny to have this now that we think that now we're all on Zoom sort of doing this, but back then it was, I guess, Periscope, this app just launched, which was allowing people to do live streams more easily, because up until then it was actually quite hard to do a live stream. So we took advantage of this, and we made a live stream of the exhibition, a tour of the exhibition, which was online, precisely because only a limited amount of people were able to actually visit this. And I'm gonna just show you this video, which is like a walkthrough of the exhibition. And the last thing I wanna say is that I wanna stress is that I think really the kind of most radical thing of this project was actually simply opening up these flats and showing them in a kind of object-trouvé way, showing them. And it was interesting because people go to an architecture biennale, but they were confronted with very banal furniture and sort of these weird features like this jacuzzi in the entrance of this flat.
Walk through, that's a very good idea.
We were very lucky with the flat. We spent hours looking for it, but this one was a ground floor flat with two direct entrances to the street. And there was a room with a jacuzzi, which was really incredible.
Yeah, actually, we had a lot of problems even with at the opening, because the woman who owned the apartment was not aware that we were going to do an exhibition. So there were a lot of issues with that, because she was obviously not happy that we were having an exhibition, and we were having, like, you know, quite a few guests actually at the opening. So she kind of appeared at the opening, you know, telling us to close the exhibition. And even there was an interesting part in terms of the exhibition making, the technicalities of the display, because we had to obviously, everything that was on show was, you know, we couldn't put screws in the wall, we couldn't do any of that. So we had to figure out ways to sort of install the whole thing in a way that was completely removable a couple of days after. And also we were living in this flat during those days. So every morning there was a very important part of the exhibition, which was the setting up of the exhibition itself and the sort of, you know, staging this flat as if it was a domestic space, but also was an exhibition space. And it was living for those 3 days in this hybrid way, because it was many things at once in a way. It was something that was the object of the exhibition, was the context of the exhibition, but was also, anyway, it was a flat to begin with, and it was also the flat that we lived in. I think we can stop here and leave it to the next group.
Okay, thank you very much, Alessandro. Right on, let's move to the second presentation. This time the presentation is going to be given by Nuno Grande. Nuno Grande is an architecture critic and researcher, associate professor at the University of Coimbra and co-curator together with Roberto Cremascoli of the Portuguese Non-Pavilion at the 15th Venice Architecture Biennale, which took place in 2016, which was labeled the Pavilion Neighbourhood, where Alvaro meets Aldo. Please, Nuno.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, the Architecture Foundation, for the invitation. Thank you, David, for your presentation. I'm going to talk on behalf of Roberto, who's not here, so it's a common project. I was hoping that he could be the present, but he could not, so I will talk about our common and shared experience on this very interesting biennale, where Alejandro Aravena, the chief curator, challenged the different countries to think about architecture as a battlefront discipline, and how could we report from the front of Portugal. And of course, when the idea was how architects are engaged with social, political, environmental causes, what does Portugal has to say about this? And of course, we immediately thought about this period of Portugal after the revolution in 1974, when a new generation of architects were engaged with the social housing issue. And of course, Alvaro Cesar was one of the key figures of this process. And not just because he was socially engaged with the social revolution, but also because he believed that the social neighborhoods should be filled in the urban fabric of the existing city. So he wanted people to come back to the center of the cities and not be expelled to the outskirts as normally happened in other social housing processes before. And of course, he learned this also from Aldo Rossi when he was written, when he wrote this book in 1966, and then we were celebrating the 50th anniversary of this book. And as Cesar, Rossi had also an approach about this idea of how an architect should be socially engaged with the problem of the impoverished people, but also how can this common basic architecture become part of the existing fabric, especially in European cities. And we're also celebrating the 40th anniversary of the first appearance of Cesar in a Biennale. This was the Biennale that Gregotti and Eisenman, a part of the Biennale of 76 that they organized on architecture. And Cesar was there explaining to all these Americans and Europeans how was the revolution in Portugal and how he was committed with this idea of infilling the social neighborhoods in the existing fabric of the city. So that's where we try to make this relationship between Cesar and Rossi, or Alvaro and Aldo. Actually, they met also in this meeting in 1976. So the problem was, how can we speak about this social commitment of architects in a pavilion that does not exist at the Giardini, because Portugal does not have a pavilion at the Giardini? Well, we don't have these kind of fancy, monumental, objectual pavilions that normally are 6 months empty and 6 months in display. But we thought that this was an opportunity also to think about the role of a pavilion. And again, Rossi had taught us in 1980 that an ephemeral building, like a pavilion, could be outside the Giardini and outside the Arsenal and dialogue with the city, challenge the city, even if it's an ephemeral and very fragile project. It could be interesting that he could be more committed with the city problems. That's when we thought, well, where should we find a place like that? And we immediately thought about this project by Alvaro Cesar at Campo di Marte, at the Giudecca Island in the south of Venice. And there, well, he won this competition in 83, but he only managed to build this L-shaped building, which half was built and the other half was still unfinished in 2016. And curiously enough, he invited Rossi to build a part of this plan. So again, there was a dialogue between these two architects in La Giudecca. And then, of course, the building was unfinished, as I said, and people were complaining about this. They even wrote a lot of graffiti on the outside of, on the fence of the unfinished site, project or construction site, saying that they were willing to have the houses that were promised to them. It was more than 10 years that the project had been started and it wasn't finished. But there was a kind of riot around this. And we thought it would be a nice idea to squat this space and to make the pavilion inside this space, in order to appeal to the authorities that this place was due to the people and it should be finished, because it was designed by this architect, important Portuguese architect, in a very important plan for the city. And we tried to convince the neighbors about this. We made a lot of meetings with them. They were very suspicious about this, but they say, okay, let's try one more time if something happens. Well, and of course we needed a content for this pavilion, and we thought maybe we should invite Alvaro Cesar to travel with us and go and see how he managed to deal with this social fabric and urban fabric in other social neighborhoods that he designed all over Europe. So we went to Venice with him. He saw his unfinished project, but mostly he spoke with the people that were already there, living there. We photographed and we filmed these encounters. And he listened to the complaints, to the praises, but also to the complaints of people about the project. And I wonder how many Pritzker Prizes normally go back to the crime scene to listen to the about his crimes, no? And I think he was very generous to do this. And we taped this, we photographed this, and then we went back to Porto and we visited this very nice project that he did after the revolution, well known. And again, he spoke with the neighbors. And again, he knows them since 1974. He battled with them for the revolution. But he also met the youngest inhabitants. Well, this neighborhood has been gentrified, as all the neighborhoods designed by important architects, even the social neighborhoods. But it was interesting to see that Caesar understands this gentrification process. It's part of the contemporary process of the return to the city center. And then we went to The Hague, and there, of course, Caesar had to compromise with the Hanseatic architecture, learning from the city, from the architecture of the city once more, but at the same time learning from the Islamic inhabitants, who were the majority of the people to whom he was designing these houses for. And when we went back in 2016, he really managed to understand how these people were living happily in his apartment. Actually, he didn't design an apartment especially for Islamic families. He made a typology that was common for the Dutch and for the Islamic immigrants. And they were happily living there. And even they could go on having their religious practices inside the building without, and inside the apartments without harming their relationships with the other. So in a way, this was a very nice lesson of typology and morphology that we received when we saw this happy family there. And then finally we went to Berlin, to his most iconic building there, the Bonjour Tristesse, also very well known. Well, this is a picture of him when he was entering the competition, young Caesar. Of course, then in 2016, he went there and he understood that the building was aging, like himself. But it was nice because he managed to find or to re-encounter the Turkish family that lived there in Kreuzberg, but also the new inhabitants again. So in a way, again, the gentrification problems, the immigration problems that he had to understand because he was revisiting his works 30 and 40 years later. So we took all this creation and creator to Venice, and we decided to occupy, as I said, to squat his building. And we thought that of using this fence where the graffiti are written inside to cover up the exhibition. And on the outside, we put all the photographs of all the visits and all the neighbors that we had visited before. And it was quite fun to see sometimes some of the people of Giudecca seeing themselves as part of the exhibition. So they became actually the subject of the exhibition. Caesar was just the vehicle for that. And now, just to finish, I'm going to show you some pictures of the pavilion. It was made in a very straightforward way with, of course, beautiful maquettes that he always produces in his office. But then, of course, we mixed our graffiti with the existing ones. We projected the films. We showed the photographs. And finally, Caesar could visit the pavilion and explain to the authorities the importance of finishing this building for the people. We did a nice tavolata. We invited all the neighbors to come, and it was quite interesting to see their reaction. And we went on the following months to Venice, and we saw how people appropriated themselves of the fence, sometimes vandalizing it, but I think in a very gentle way, I would have to say. Even when they make these kind of jokes about the architect, they desacralize the personage of Caesar. And that was one of our goals, to desacralize the architect. And this way he became one of them, one neighbor more. Actually, they even discovered that he likes to smoke, which is quite fun. So in a way, Caesar became a common citizen for them. And of course, we published this in a catalog by Headstands. But the most rewarding thing, I'm now finishing, the most rewarding thing for us was the chance to finish the building. Actually, after the pavilion was dismantled, the authorities were so ashamed that this building was still like we found it, that they decided to finish it. And so for us, more than the pavilion itself, it was the rewarding happening after that. And now, as I heard, some new families are going to be living there very soon. And that's, for us, it's the most important thing. So just to finish, what is the conclusion I got from this? Well, We could have done something in the pavilion, something at a Giardini, because normally at the Giardini pavilions, architecture becomes very nice display. But what I really like about our project, about our non-pavilion, it's because there in Giudecca, it was a display who became architecture. It was a display who became a real building for people to live in. And I'm very thankful to the people of Giudecca who helped us to do that. That's why I want to thank them in the Veneto writing and accent. Grazie a tutti. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nuno, for your presentation. So now let's switch to the third and last participant of the day, my two fellow comrades of the Unfolding Pavilion. So the Unfolding Pavilion made by Daniel Tudor Munteanu, who's an architect and urban planner based in Suceava, in Romania. Apart from being a founding member of the Unfolding Pavilion, he's also founder and editor of the research project Off Houses, a collection of old forgotten houses. And we also have Sara Favargiotti, who's associate professor of landscape architecture and architectural design studio at the University of Trento. And she's been curator with Daniel and me of the second edition of the Unfolding Pavilion, which was titled Little Italy. Please, Daniel and Sara. Maybe you have to unmute Daniel. We can't hear you. You're muted. I am muting you now. Okay.
Can you hear me?
Now we can.
Okay. Thank you, Davide. I will very quickly present the first edition of the Unfolding Pavilion. The Unfolding Pavilion pops up at major architectural events. In previously inaccessible but architecturally significant buildings. The Unfolding Pavilion not only opens these buildings to the general public, but organizes exhibitions and events in the space it occupies. All the works inside the Unfolding Pavilion are site-specific. They are specially commissioned works that react to the wider cultural and social context of the building they are displayed into. So just like Nuno said earlier, if usually in architectural exhibitions, architecture becomes display, in the Unfolding Pavilion as well, the display become architecture. Without an exhibition space of the finest architectural making, the Unfolding Pavilion doesn't have any reason to exist. The first Unfolding Pavilion took place in 2016 in Ignazio Gardella's Casa Lezzatere of 1953, that you see here beautifully photographed by Giorgio Casali. Casa Lezzatere was the only 20th century architectural masterpiece that was built along a major Venetian canal. Casa Lezzatere is a private condominium with luxury apartments that no one was able to experience before from the inside. Luckily, we managed to spot one of its apartments, where else but on Airbnb. And we immediately booked it for the opening days of the 15th Venice Architecture Biennale. The interior of this apartment was not ideal, to put it mildly, but we managed to transform the apartment into a, let's say, generous and beautiful exhibition space. And you see here the living room of the apartment with a chandelier by Davide Trabucco, a huge pencil drawing in the background by Fabio Alessandro Fusco, some other works by Falatelier and Valenzuela Pinto, but also a coffee table with the old Casabella Continuità issue of July 1958, where the building was first published. Other works were displayed on the bedroom floor, on the curtain hanger, basically in all corners of the apartment, even in the closet. and even in the bathroom. Surprisingly, several hundred people attended our opening, and in the few days of its existence, the space not only became an unconventional gallery, but also a meeting place for quite long and casual conversations. Of course, just like the curators of the Airbnb Pavilion, we also slept inside the pavilion, which after hours returned to its domestic use. Everything was thoroughly archived on our website, which again always has a design inspired by the building's most recognizable motifs. For the 2018 edition of the Venice Architecture Biennale, we crossed the canal to the island of Giudecca, directly opposite to the Casa Lezzatere, where we occupied another fabulous building that Sara will present next.
Yes. So for the second, in 2018, I joined Daniel and Davide and in the curatorial project of the second edition of the Unfolding Pavilion. As mentioned, we open up another fantastic buildings, the social housing complex designed by Gino Valle on the Giudecca Island, very close, actually next to the Hilton Mulino Stucchi, which is you can see below. And it's a very interesting site studying the, because as you see here, it was a at the beginning, and it was a long history across this site, and you can see some sign of the precedent, the former occupation of the site, which was a cement factory. And the very interesting aspect is that for the city council recording to allow a compulsory purchase for to realize such a housing, a public housing complex, and was very during the 70s more or less. So the complex was completed around in the 1986, and it's structured by following the main characteristic of the Venetian path, like the campi and the small calle and these very stretch spaces, and which open up in some court, and which this very different typology of and innovative typology of apartments that characterize the site. And it offers around 90 apartments, but what we found very intriguing and also interesting to develop that among the 90 apartments, around 10 of those are empty, are unoccupied, and since many years. So this question, this issue of empty apartments in the public social housing was very very interesting for us, and we also had the chance to enter in one of those buildings, specifically this one, the number 7. And the aims of the project was to somehow was the occasion to refurbish this apartment, one of the triplex units that has this wonderful access from the elevated walkway and offers a beautiful, thanks to the triplex structure, a beautiful view to the Laguna, but also to the city center and to the complex itself. So we had this opportunity to take this opportunity to refurbish this place and to convert in a temporary gallery of works, but also an active let's say space of artistic experimental artistic space. No, as it signed here in the official document that we had to sign with the public owners of the social complex. So it was in that sense an experimental artistic space that hosted site-specific installation made by many more than 50 teams and groups of architects, and also more and more participants to the public events that we hosted exactly in these in the open spaces, but also in the inner part of the apartments. But it also many site-specific project and design installation, but also some materials and maquettes and drawings made made by got it from the archive of Gino Valle, and also the 3 days long program of public events, and last but not least, it hosted us. It was our living spaces. Of course, we live for a very intense period during the vernissage, but also we live together, and we start to create an interaction with the communities, which was very a strong part of this process. And here we can see, like, again, as unexpected somehow, during the opening, many people attended the openings, the event, and we can also see briefly some of the site-specific installation that somehow were characterized the public space, starting from the pathway, the walkway, the pathway, open-air pathway, and the campi, the squares in the cities, in the city, in the center part of the complex. So some of the public events that have been addressing during the 3 days, and also some site-specific installation on the third floor and in the other parts of the floors of the apartment. So what is interesting about beyond the event itself and the exhibition itself, what was somehow the legacy of this process was, from one side, that we have the chance to reconnect, reactivate a community, a sense of community that was lost during these years, because many of these people, these our friends, of the people, the inhabitants, are still the same people that inhabited since the beginning. And so we gave them, or we let know also see the things, the place where they're living in a different way, and a place that they have to take care somehow. And on the other hand, we return an apartment to the citizens of Venice, refurbished and again available to host a new family.
Okay, that's it, Sara. Thank you very much. So we can now switch to the next part of the talk. If you can stop sharing the screen, Sara, maybe, so we can see each other's. Or is it Daniel? Daniel, maybe you should stop sharing the screen. Okay, great. So now, in the remaining part of the conversation, we have some, let's say, a little bit more than 20 minutes, 23 actually. I would like to allow basically our guests to interact on several topics which emerged, starting from what has been presented until now. And of course, as said before, if someone from the audience feels like they want to also intervene, please don't hesitate and write something in the chat box so we can include you in the conversation. In order to make this second part of the talk a little bit smooth, instead of asking precise questions to each one of the guests, I'm gonna just throw some, let's say, points on the table, some topics, and then please, anyone who feels like expanding on any one of them, please do so. So of course, for what we have seen in these three projects, there's a serious question of what an architecture pavilion, what an architecture exhibition is, or what it should do, basically, which means also, what does it mean to exhibit architecture, like especially in relationship to what would be the traditional canonical idea of what an architecture exhibition is. There is an important topic, of course, which is what the curator of an architecture exhibition is, what is the, let's say, the background, because here we see different approaches to curating, which somehow are related to the different backgrounds from which everybody comes from. Architects tend to curate as architects, and writers as writers, and curators, whatever that figure is. It's already quite difficult in the art, but maybe in the architecture world even more. Of course, the three projects, they open up an important issue, which is this articulation of the social, so the way in which the social is integrated and somehow brought to the fore by means of the exhibition, so the different ways of including people who are not necessarily related to the architecture world, and why and how this can be actually performed, this activation. There's the question of what do architecture exhibitions produce. I heard, especially from the Airbnb Pavilion, I think Alessandro said that exhibitions are excuses, no, to say something different or to produce a statement. But then the question is, how does this, what is this statement supposed to deliver or to produce? And then I see that there's different ways of relating with the Venice Architecture Biennale, all ambiguous, to be honest, because I see in each one of the projects some criticism. At the same time, they all somehow depend on the existence of the Biennale itself. So to me, these are more or less some of the most intriguing points that have been, let's say, that have emerged until now. Does anyone from our guests want to expand on any one of these topics?
Yeah, I can start just because you just mentioned something that I said. I'm happy mm-hmm. to say something in response. So I think what I, it was very nice to see the presentations because the other projects, I didn't see them in person. And the main thing that came up for me was the reflection on the idea that an exhibition of architecture is first and foremost an exhibition. An architecture exhibition is first and foremost an exhibition of architecture. I think what these projects show, which is very unlike the situation in the Giardini, in the case of this particular Biennale of Venice, we all in different ways understood the idea of exhibiting architecture as exhibiting the accomplished fact of a three-dimensional building, which is actually, if you think about the history of exhibiting architecture, it always happened only in two modes, in a way. On the one hand, you have stuff, you know, moments like the International Bauausstellung in Germany after the war, where you had, or you know, all these different moments where architecture exhibitions consisted in actually unveiling built buildings, where you actually would experience buildings, you would understand architecture as a discipline which is concerned with like the real world. It exists in a very specific way in the world. And on the other hand, you have these exhibitions that were, for example, popular at the MoMA, also after the war, where you would actually display, there was this idea of the future of living. So architecture exhibitions were always pretty straightforward, where either accomplished buildings built realities or ideas about the future of the future of buildings or the future of the domestic space or whatever. The future of construction, you have all the 1920s exhibitions about the future of construction. You have the, you know, the universal exhibitions about technologies of building and all these types of ways of showing architecture. And only in recent years, you've had the emergence of the idea of showing something from the point of view of the architectural gaze, or the way that architects have to look at something. So this has been, for me, a complete shift, because then the practice of showing architecture has entered a very similar space that is the one of showing art, because you are showing a point of view on something. You're not showing architecture as this means that we've understood in a very clear way, but you're showing something that has more to do with the architectural gaze. And in fact, you know, when I was looking at the other exhibitions, I think this question is still, it's very evident, because on the one hand you have the buildings that were on show, and it was amazing actually, as Nuno was saying, like, you know, the outcome of your project was, the best outcome of that project was actually the fact that the real building, through the exhibition, through again, the excuse of the exhibition, you had an impact of an actual building. And the exhibition was mostly, let's say, a documentation of a process, in a way. There wasn't like an artwork of show. There were a few, you know, maquettes, but it was mostly the process of making this, and then the outcome of this process, which was the building. So in a way, it's almost, one could claim that, you know, in a way the exhibition was really a process, was not really the moment where you exhibited more traditionally something.
Maybe I can, if you don't mind, Alessandro, I can interrupt you here and move to Nuno, because you've been addressing him directly. I think that the example of the of the exhibition of the Portuguese Pavilion is extremely interesting in this sense, because Nuno has always been extremely critical and plainly, publicly critical of the Biennale. So he's always used this exhibition as an example or a prototype of another way of doing a pavilion. From this point of view, I think there's two interesting things, no? Like, as you said, Alessandro, you said, Nuno, that the content was the process, the content was the people, but still, of course, you've been exhibiting models from Alvaro Siza, so there's still, this jumping from one from a canonical exhibition to a experimental exhibition, which is something in particular, I think, of your project. And then again, this idea of criticizing the Biennale from within, which is particularly interesting, at least, no, to address. Well, do you want to start?
I think curatorship is a political act. I think when we are thinking about how architecture changes people's lives, we have to address this political issue. When I'm talking about political, I'm thinking about the polis, the city. And one of the things I criticize in the Venice Biennale is that everything is very enclosed in spaces where you have to get through a ticket or an invitation normally. Of course, normally when you don't do it, it's because you're visiting another country which does not have a pavilion in the Giardini. So the Giardini has become a kind of a theme park for architects, and the Arsenale a kind of shopping mall for architects. And in my point of view, I think we should think about the investment that countries do in these pavilions. Maybe it should be well spent by helping the city of Venice itself to be requalified, renewed, there should be a more interactive way between exhibitions and the city itself, as we saw in these three cases. And maybe the good thing would be, at least one year, to leave the Giardini totally empty. Maybe the COVID-19 helped us to think about this year. So we will have an empty space for a year, which might make us think that maybe the future of the Biennale should be about relating, dialoguing with the city itself, and not again making vanity fairs as normally we see in this kind of exhibitions. Of course, I'm being too provocative, but I think it's a moment to also to think about this. That's why we call it a non-pavilion. For us, the pavilion was just a way of showing a process, yes.
But then at the same time, in your case, it was not just activism. I mean, you've been showing projects by Caesar.
Yes, I'm not a social activist. I'm an architect. I like architecture. But I think you should speak about architecture in a political way, in a way people can understand. Of course, we have put models, but I think models are intelligible things. When people get in, they understand the block, they understand the position of the building in the block. So in a way, we try to speak through words and through objects that people can understand, which are also part of their lives in a way. But I'm an architect, I believe in architecture, and I believe that in the way architects express themselves, of course.
Does this make the Giardini really redundant? I don't know if someone from the Unfolding Pavilion wants to say something about our ambiguous relationship with the Biennale, very ambiguous relationship with the Biennale itself. Daniel, or...
I will shortly say something about that. I mean, we depend on major events like the Venice Biennale to happen because we are in a way a sort of parasites to these big institutions. We are not associated in any official way with the Biennale. Everything we have done until now is self-initiated. And one very important aspect is that all the three pavilions that were presented today were not behind the paywall of the Biennale, but instead were distributed in the city and sometimes quite far away from Giardini itself. So Let's say that the Biennale is an important event that has to go on, but is important not only because what it exhibits in the official Biennale grounds, but also because it somehow allows these non-official events to happen.
What's the relationship with the Biennale Airbnb Pavilion? Because somehow you mentioned the Colas concept for the Biennale, but of course this was somehow related or unrelated. I think that's there's an interesting point there.
Yeah, I can respond to this question, picking up also on Daniel's point about the notion of being a parasite. I'd like to challenge maybe this notion to say that, in a way, yes, of course, all unofficial events depend on the Biennale, but I think it's also problematic to recognize the Biennale as being the sole voice and the sole sort of authority, no, which has the authority to decide what gets exhibited and what's not. In a sense, I think in our case, as young graduates, for example, we recognized that in a way a series of phenomena which were unfolding in the world made in a way the canonical sort of self-reflexive sort of gaze which biennales have or architects have in biennale sound completely trivial to actually new technologies and new trends and new ways of experiencing, for example, domestic space in our case, were disrupting completely the world. And I think with regards to the whole parasite question, it is, or probably to pick up on where Alessandro left the discussion on how architectural exhibitions now are concerned mostly with the architect's gaze, I think it's not surprising that of the 2014 Biennale, for example, the only thing in the Biennale the New York Times covered was actually our pavilion, because it recognized our pavilion as the only one which was speaking about a true sociological, political, and cultural problem in a Biennale which was otherwise entirely looking onto itself. So I think those are interesting points to raise, especially with regards to who has the authority of saying what and when and by what means.
Yeah, I want to add something to this because it's interesting because actually at the next edition of the Biennale, we participated inside the British Pavilion. So actually it so happened that we did a project which was again, you know, outside parasitical, as Fabrizio was saying. You know, it questioned the very structure of the Biennale. In fact, we also spoke about the idea of the Biennale representing a world that in a way If I mean, we couldn't claim it didn't exist anymore, but this idea of you know, countries and representation and this kind of you know, we were sensing that we already lived in a global world, and this idea of like national representation felt very strange to us back then. And then actually at the next Biennale, we participated inside the British Pavilion precisely in the moment in the summer where Brexit happened. So actually, that Biennale was interesting because we participated inside. When we were inside, we actually tried to also question the pavilion itself, and we participated with this kind of provocative project because the agenda of the pavilion in 2016 was to actually show one-to-one models of architectures. And we displayed, for example, an inflatable toy, essentially, that you could go inside and this was our idea of the future of the domestic space, this kind of like bubble sort of idea. And yeah, it happened the same year of Brexit. And actually we drafted a letter where we were trying to question the very idea of this kind of like national representation in a very strange moment where of weird nationalism, for example, in Britain.
In that case, you were not curating, no, you were authors of a work which was exhibited as part of the pavilion. Something which I find particularly interesting is that in the three examples that we saw today, the Unfolding Pavilion, the Airbnb Pavilion, and the Portuguese Pavilion, somehow one thing that keeps them all together is that the exhibition, the concept of the exhibition, the curatorial project becomes an extremely strong point of the whole thing, even so strong that in the end, the exhibited works become ancillary, no? Somehow gravitate around the main curatorial concept. In the end, we could speak of the specific works which were exhibited, but those are apparently less relevant than the process itself. There's a famously a big question of how do curators enter into the process of production of an exhibition if they take too much protagonism, that I think also an English word, and or whether they should facilitate the authors to somehow produce their works. And I somehow feel that in these three cases, we have curators which take really very much the lead somehow, and they act maybe a little bit like architects because architects want to have a lot of control usually. So maybe, I don't know if this is also because of the way we are formed, which makes us act in this way. I don't know if you want to, someone wants to elaborate a little bit, no? Between the container and the content, what comes forward the most in the end?
Well, in our case, it was very difficult to beat Cesar as an author. But in a way, we tried not to touch the building. As you saw, it was left empty as an empty void as it was. We enclosed it because of for security reasons. And we made the people to discover what is behind an apartment building, so people could see the structure, could see the process also of construction of the building, which is normally a thing that you cannot visit when you're not an architect or when you're a common citizen. You don't visit places of under construction. So in a way, we, as I said, we Cesar was the vehicle. But we tried to desacralize a little bit the idea that of the author, as we saw, it doesn't. And we wanted also to show how architects can fail and what can they do about this failure? What can they, how do they react to it? And so we tried to make of this failure a reason to think about architecture as a social and a political discipline. Yeah, I don't know if I answered your question.
No, I think you did, but also maybe we have three more minutes. One thing which I like to address before we finish the time at our disposal. I mean, in your case, Nuno, the legacy of your project was extremely important because I don't remember if you already said it, but like after the exhibition was finished, the attention of the public was brought back to the building, which was not finished yet. So it was eventually complete. Is it complete now? I think.
Well, not yet, because of course we are in Italy.
And all right.
Now there was another problem with the entrepreneur afterwards, and they had to change it. But now I think it's on the good track. Yeah, but it was not easy. It was not easy at all.
But then the question is, and both to the other two groups, so to the Unfolding Pavilion and the Airbnb Pavilion, what's the legacy of your project, or do you even care about the possible legacy of what you're doing as curators with your exhibition?
I can add something. Actually, it was the previous connected to the previous sentence of Nuno. So it was somehow I was also reflecting that our act it's in this concern about the contents and the content somehow it was in our case was a kind of a mediation of several things and mediation of some constraints, mediation of political also issue, administrative bureaucratical issues in sense of, for example, starting from and actually the main means and main connection within the communities and starting to achieve like the goal, which was also one of the goals of the legacy that you mentioned and that you are asking. And I mentioned before, one of being the community more engaged and more responsible somehow of the story of the past, of the space, the place, the quality of the place where they're living, was exactly live with them and make the works. And I mean, the expanding time of the previous months that let us being there, doing ourselves the works and connected to the people was one of the strongest tools that we address interested to get somehow also the response of a community that, that at the beginning was very, very much skeptical, no, somehow. And then, of course, the tools, the means of architecture with the site-specific installation, yeah, somehow maybe site, on the site, or not, I would not say not relevant, but somehow were exactly the means to express, to tell, to talk, to somehow to show inside the site itself some specific meaning, some interpretation, or the squares, the main squares, the central patio, the central areas of the spaces, how could be addressed differently, not the strongness of this and the qualities of this space. So and reconnected to your last question, those are, as I mentioned before, the two legacy which I found very important on my point of view. Now, what's from one side the community, how could be somehow reconsider themselves in the space where they're living, and of course the return of this place, which was just as individual act. It cannot change all the system of social housing, of course, but somehow get a return, no, a return back to the communities.
We are beyond the time. I don't know if there's still some time for the Airbnb Pavilion, if they want to add something, maybe also regarding the topic of the legacy of what they have done, and then we conclude this.
I think the legacy, our project, you know, I know this also answers the question of curators and their authorship. I mean, for us, we formed, just after that project, we formed an art collective that made exhibition making its main practice. Actually, so we actually went on for 4 years between 2014 and 2018 to produce many, many exhibitions in institutions in Europe, and mainly Europe and the US, in museums and different kinds of places, where we actually became, you know, carried on the discourse and the ideas that were born in Airbnb, and we sort of kept reflecting and amplified the range of that research. I think the legacy was a very defined project which lasted for 4 years, which we're actually looking to put into a book as soon as we manage. I think the legacy was pretty much defined in this way.
So it was a private, let's say, legacy, but which allowed you to produce and continue experimenting, which is pretty nice, actually. I think that we
Can I just say something about the other two exhibitions not ours, but the other two. I think they also address the issue of tourism in Venice, which I think it's also a very interesting subject, because they use the touristical process and, you know, the mainstream capitalistic logic of getting into an Airbnb space, and then it's subverted from the inside. And I think this kind of subversive attitude, using the market logic to question the market itself, or using tourism to question tourism itself, I think it's a very nice strategy. I think it's, if we want a legacy of this kind of operations, is how can we apparently live in this kind of capitalistic market-driven world and go on rethinking some aspects of it and showing them straightforward, like I think these projects do.